Spark Streaming is an extension of the core Spark API that allows data engineers and data scientists to process real-time data from various sources, including Kafka, Flume, and Amazon Kinesis. This processed data can be pushed out to file systems, databases, and live dashboards. Understanding the importance of this, we have come up with this Spark Streaming tutorial. Now, before we go ahead with the session, I'd like to inform you guys that we have launched a completely free platform called Great Learning Academy, where you have access to free courses such as AI, Cloud, and Digital Marketing. You can check out the details in the description below. Now, let's have a quick glance at the agenda. We start up by understanding what is real-time analytics. Then we'll understand the difference between batch and real-time processing. After that, we'll have an introduction to Spark Streaming. Finally, we'll have a demo on Twitter Streaming.
So let's get started.
So what do you think is real-time analytics rather than me talking about it, right? I can take some help, by the way. So what do you people think is real-time analytics? What is your idea? Okay, analyzing the data as and when it comes. What else? So real-time analytics is not a new branch. Actually, real-time analysis was there for long back. Okay, so real-time analytics in general is that you are analyzing the data as and when the data comes. And that is a separate branch of analytics. Because so far, whatever you're doing, you do Spark, you do Hadoop, you do machine learning, that can be there. But any branch of analysis you do, you are working on static data. Your data is there, you are not moving it. So that is called data in rest. And then we have data in motion. So data in rest is easy to handle because the data is there. It is not moving anywhere. You just query the data or you do whatever you want. But data in motion is very difficult to handle because you need systems which can handle real-time data, and you need to take care of things like fault tolerance. What will happen if my system breaks? What if I lose real-time data? And the speed of processing and all these things becomes a challenge when you go to real-time analytics. And there are n number of examples, we will discuss them for real-time analytics. But technically speaking, real-time analytics means you are analyzing the data as in when it comes, right? So we learned the three V's of big data. Their velocity stands for real-time analytics, right? So volume, velocity, variety. Streaming data can be generated from thousands of sources, which typically send in the data records simultaneously. Ability to collect and process terabytes of data in real time, that is streaming data analytics. And it is a very interesting field. Starting from ad recommendations, like you are browsing some website and you start getting recommendations and ads, starting from there, okay, to a lot of like fraud detection. Like I said, if you're swiping your credit card and immediately you're getting a call saying that did you actually make it? And customized offers, like I use HDFC Bank. So when I make an online transaction, I'll get an SMS saying that here is an offer for you. You transacted for this much, here is an offer for you. So all this is analyzing the data in real time. And of course, Twitter, like streaming the Twitter data in live and then predicting trends. So it's very popular, right? So like when the World Cup matches and all are happening, like which team is the popular, which player is the popular. All this has to be real time, right? You can't start the prediction now, right? The World Cup matches are over. So now if you start the prediction, it's basically useless. So all these are examples of real time analytics. And Spark is excellent at doing this. That is what we have to understand. So I have collected, or we have collected some of the use cases where some of them I have worked on, some of them my friend has worked on. This fraud detection in credit card using bank transaction, right? So the next question is that how do you do this? Is Spark the only framework which can do this? And no, Spark is the latest one. Spark is very new, right? So before Spark also people used to do all these things, right? Old days MapReduce used to do this, but that was very slow because you know MapReduce will take a lot of time to process your data. And one of the frameworks where I have worked a little bit is called Apache Storm. There is something called Apache Storm. STORM. Storm no longer exists. It's very rare to see Storm, but I have personally worked in 2012 in Storm. Because in that point in time, Storm was the only framework which can handle real-time data. And Storm trainings were like, I was not an expert in Storm, but people were ready to pay any money for Storm training. Because Storm was the only real-time processing engine. And so the problem with Storm is it's a separate framework. So you have to learn it separately, its API, its commands or whatever you have. And then you have to install it in a cluster, Storm, and it starts working. Then you have to integrate that with your Hadoop or whatever. So it's not a default framework on Hadoop. And Storm can in fact read data from anywhere. You don't need HDFS. It can read from anywhere. But people had big data. So what they used to do, they will set up a Storm cluster and then connect that with Hadoop. Citibank was using the same infrastructure. They were having a Storm cluster for credit card fraud detection. And Storm is good actually. Storm is a very nice framework. Even today the framework exists, but very less people actually use it, right? Second is like ad optimization and targeting based on each visit, like. So when you see these ads, there are two things. One is showing the ad. Second is, because like I said, this ad optimization, right? One is like showing the ad. Second is the personalization of ad. Like one, the ad should come. Second, the personalization should come. So sometimes you can see that if you visit Amazon or something, the ads will pop up, but it will be based on the personalization of either the category of the customer. So let's say you are browsing from a particular city, based on that trend, it will show the ad. So all this has to happen and real time, it has to show the ad. So there also real time processing is used a lot. Third is again, personalized content for ad. Self-driving cars, your artificial intelligence, right? And machine learning, where if you're building a self-driving car or something, it has to make real time decisions when to stop, when probably not to kill the people, right? When to kill the people, something like that. And social media trends, Twitter top trending keywords, Facebook top trending keywords, these things are real time. IoT sensors. We have worked with Bosch in one of the projects where we were handling IoT data. So there's a company called Bosch, right? So they had a home industry solution where they will compute the thermal variations in factories. So they had installed some sensors across the factories. The factories were in Japan, and these sensors will calculate some variation in thermal power and other things. So this is sensor data. And then Bosch themselves have a way to give structure to this data. So they will create sort of like a table, actually. And then they will send the data, okay? So what we were doing, I had actually built a small case study based on this, but I don't have it right now. But basically what we were doing is that, so this was their factory, let's say group of factories or whatever, I don't know. So from here, the sensor data will come. So sensors will collect the data. So once sensors collect the data, this Bosch had a system where they will create sort of like a tabular structure. It's not a table, but they will give a row column sort of structure in a particular system. They had an application here, right? Now our requirement was that, so this data was really huge. We were getting around 3 million lines of data in a week, actually. So then their requirement was that they were doing a lot of machine learning and all on top of this data. So they had a data science team. So they will give us the requirement saying that get this data and there are some parameters in the data. Catch those parameters and then they have some equation. So apply this equation and if that crosses a particular threshold, then either you have to alert them or so sometimes you have to send an alert to them or sometimes you have to classify the data. It's not good. So what we were doing, once we get the tabular data here, right? So here the data will come, then you have to pull the data. So this was a bit back, not very recently. We were using Flume here, okay? In Flume, you have a spool directory source. There is a source called spool directory. What this will do, Flume will pull a folder. If a file lands in the folder, it will pull it. That's pull directory source. So basically, there will be a folder where the sensor data will be loaded. And what Flume will do, the moment that file lands here, Flume will pull it, this file. And then Flume was directly giving to Spark. We were not using Kafka because it was a testing setup at that point in time. So from Flume, you have a Kafka sync. It will send it to Spark. So once Spark gets the data, what we used to do, we will read it and convert it into a data frame. That is the easiest way. So you can do that within Spark streaming, okay? You will convert it into a data frame and then you will push it into a Hive table. So end of the day, it will land in Hive here. And decisions, anything we have to take, we will apply here. Okay, there were decisions. So if the data need to be alerted or something, then we will send an alert. So there was a separate system. Otherwise, so this Hive table will keep on populating. Because from there you are getting the data and all these transformations will happen. And this should not stop. That is a problem. The Spark streaming which we were doing should not stop because it is continuous data. You can never... And this customer was very specific. So Spark was running on top of Hadoop, right? And we were using a visualization tool called Splunk. There is something called Splunk. So you can integrate Splunk with Hadoop, okay? So as and when Spark processes the data, right? If the data is of interest, it will dump it into a folder here. And immediately Splunk will cache the data and Splunk will visualize the data. Splunk can give you charts and dashboards and all. It is a visualization data. So we were able to see that visualization also, dashboards and all. At the same time, the customer will be getting, Splunk can send you alerts. That is why they were using Splunk. They send an email alert saying that, between this and this time, there is some interesting data, variation in sensor, something, and customer will look into it. Splunk will come after the processing. So in Spark, we will take a decision whether this data is of interesting or not. If the data is, whether the data is interesting or not, it will dump it into a Hive table. But if the data is interesting, we will extract certain part of the data and dump it into a folder on Hadoop. So Splunk can actually take that data and give you as a dashboard. So this customer can look at this dashboard and understand where are the changes. Because if you say there is a change in data, how do you visualize the data, right? So visualization also had to come in that point. So they were using Splunk as their visualization tool. In fact, there is something called Hunk. The Splunk connector for Hadoop is called Hunk. So Splunk plus Hadoop is called Hunk. So we were using this connectivity actually. End of the day, it didn't work the way we expected. We made a test run and all, but then the customer came up with a lot of other requirements. We had to change this, that and all. And this was dismantled, but it was working fine as per their expectation. Okay. One drawback here is that since you are using Flume to collect the data, there is a reliability problem here in Flume. Like it may fail or may not fail. Flume is not 100% reliable. Second thing, it is point-to-point delivery. That means this data cannot be used by anyone else. Like this is where your original data is there. The original data is directly landing in Spark for processing, right? What if someone else also needs the original data? They have to come here. Because Flume is point-to-point delivery. It won't allow anybody else to take the data. If I was using Kafka here, multiple people could have taken the data. But at that point in time, we were building it using Flume just to get a feel of it. Right. And the trial run went very successfully, but later I don't know what happened with that project. So some projects you will be doing only POCs. That is very common in big data. You do a proof of concept and then you demonstrate to the client. And if they are happy, they will say, okay, you modify it slightly here and there, and then we will implement it. So I'm saying this is an example of how we were getting IoT. This was pure IoT data, which we were getting in this sensor example. You know HFT? High frequency trading. It's like, there is a company, right? What is his name? Twin Towers. There is a very famous company in HFT, Twin Towers or Two Towers. HFT is your stock trading, but in a different way. Like high frequency trading, meaning what they do is that they will do trading in real time. Like they will analyze all the data this minute and predict the stock next minute. So usually that doesn't happen because
lot of data is there. You can't analyze all the data.
So usually the stock market works in a way that they will analyze historical data and predict what is going to happen. But what if some news came just now, you know, and probably you need to make a buying or selling decision based on last half an hour news. So that is where HFT companies, so they do real-time stock prediction, whether the price will go up or down or something like that. There is a company, Two Towers or Twin Towers, some name is there. I have not worked personally, but there is one example of that.
HFT is very successful actually, but it is very costly. For you to invest also, it is very costly actually, right? And again, website traffic monitoring, right? Network cluster monitoring. So why website traffic monitoring and network cluster monitoring are all are important? Like why they are important? Why should you monitor website traffic or network traffic?
Yeah, one will be security. Second will be what? There is too many traffic. You should manage it, right? Whether people are logging in or not, all these things. Geolocation targeting on real time based on user location. I think that is what you said, right? When you, let's say you turn on Google and you go to a place, they will ask you to rate it immediately. Or they will recommend nearby places and all. Intelligence and surveillance. Video analytics to help with personalized interactive experience. E-commerce, that is regular, like any buying and selling that happens in e-commerce is based on this. And pricing and analytics, the list will go on. There are thousands of use cases. So real-time analytics is growing day by day because everything is happening as and when you interact with the data, right? These are some of the big companies which are using RTA, right? So Uber actually collects about 80 terabytes of data every day, and they make use of it by applying this surge pricing. You have the surge pricing, right? Sometimes when you try to catch the cab, it'll say what? When you actually book an Uber cab, right? When you say book an Uber cab, let's say there'll be 10 cabs near to you and you will get one cab. And that is not random. They won't send you a random cab. That will have a lot of parameters applied. My rating, his rating, and my history, like how many rides I took, whether I preferred this kind of a ride and my comments. So they run a machine learning model there to predict what the customer will actually like. 10 cars will be similar, right? Almost similar cars, imagine. 10 micro or 10 mini or something like that, right? I have worked with Ola in one of their projects, okay? But I have not worked in this side. We were dealing on the NoSQL side, MongoDB. They were using MongoDB. So these cabs are made available using NoSQL. That is where NoSQL databases. You have done with NoSQL? No, so it's not like one person's rating alone. So if you just want to give a rating, then everybody should get good drivers, right? I mean, so what will happen if multiple people request, right? How do you say that this driver should go to this person? So the algorithm has to take a lot of factors in effect, like how many number of rides he has completed, and then what is his rating, and what is your rating? Are you a new user or are you an old user? And what was your ratings given to similar drivers? So all this has to apply to an algorithm to choose the best driver for you. If this does not work, if you send random drivers, that is the end of your business, right? Because if everybody is getting random drivers, chances are very high everybody will rate bad, right? If I don't have any logic in sending driver, if I trust all the drivers in Uber saying that everybody will be good, right? Then my business will go down. I cannot do that. So everything runs with a prediction that, okay, this guy might be the good driver for you, ideally, right? Uber says they do like that. I mean, we don't have a complete access, but when I was in the Ola project, they were also doing similar. And they won't exactly tell you what they're doing. I mean, it's internal to the company, what features they are looking for the customer or the driver. So I was working in the MongoDB side in Ola, meaning
So our problem was how the caps will be available. See, you are opening your mobile and then you are searching for the cap. First requirement is what? The cap should be there, or you should see something. The system should work. That is where NoSQL comes into picture. NoSQL, what it does is that it will give you like 50-50. I mean, NoSQL is always like it, you cannot rely on NoSQL. So NoSQL is where the place where they have hosted their cap details and all. So if, let's say, 1 million or 10 million people open Uber or Ola app, they will get served. The app will work, connectivity will be established, and they will search. Whether you get a cab or not, that's not their problem. Because that cannot be guaranteed. If you have 10 million, 20 million people searching, search may become slow because you cannot just assume a cab will come. It has to be practically handled. But the initial connection and pooling of cab is done by MongoDB. And then when you actually search and click on a cab, I want this cab or give me a cab, then MongoDB will not be in picture. Because from there onwards, it is reliable transaction, right? I don't know what they were using for that, but some sort of a combination of OLTP system, I think, because search, basically search, like search of all. So what MongoDB actually did there was that the moment you open, it will tag your location. So MongoDB has something called a geospatial indexing, which is very special to MongoDB. It can index your data based on location. And I don't think that feature is available in many other NoSQL databases. So normally you can do indexing, primary indexing, secondary indexing, but here you can do geospatial indexing, which is very fast, the searches. So the moment you turn on your location services and the cap, it'll index everything very fast and make sure that you see some cap near you or something like that. So that search part, whether the cap is there, all these things are handled by MongoDB. But the moment you book a cab actually, then the transaction has to be reliable, right? So MongoDB is only in the initial phase. When you actually book the cab, then Ola cannot say that after a half an hour, oh, I didn't see you booked a cab. Okay, that is not possible. It must come if you book, or it should cancel. So from there onwards, they were using some sort of a combination of OLTP system to handle those requests. Yes, that is handled by MongoDB, I'm saying, because it can handle millions or billions of connections. It will never fail in the initial stage. If you were using a regular RDBMS or something, chances are very high, if those many queries hit, it will fail or it will get slowed down. So here it is very rare that in the cab booking apps, it will slow down or initial page will load. When you actually search, it will get slow. Then the cab may or may not come. That's a different story. But that initial handling, that is where NoSQL databases are excellent. Because they also work in a distributed cluster like this. There, no, there it was not in Hadoop. They were having a... No. Not in Hadoop, you have HBase. HBase is the NoSQL database on top of Hadoop, the default one. And HBase is not so cheap. It's very costly setup. So people don't directly go for HBase much. MongoDB and all can be installed in any cluster. You don't need Hadoop for that. You can just bring up 10 machines and MongoDB will work, right? So they were not using Hadoop for that. Only for this large customer request, IRCTC, another example. Again, NoSQL. Initial, login and search, NoSQL. IRCTC is not using MongoDB, some other DB, NoSQL. But anyway, NoSQL, right? So that is why previously you had an issue of connections getting disconnected and all, and then IRCTC said that we are moving to a new infrastructure. Now, even during peak hours, you can log in, right? The service is better now, right? Because they migrated to NoSQL. So you get reliability, at least in the terms of search and getting the data. Again, Flipkart and Amazon, even if millions of people are visiting, okay, you can click on an iPhone picture, it will show. The page will load. DynamoDB. Because it is storing key value pairs behind the scene. Easy search and easy retrieval. So during your this thing, right? Big Billion Day or the nonsense show they run, right? You are able to log in, you are able to see, but you will not get the product. Correct. You can log in, you can see the product, you will not get the product. Because getting is different. Getting is OLTP. Seeing the product and offers is NoSQL. It will say that I have these many laptops and these many computers, please come. But once you make payment, you reach that page, then NoSQL cannot handle. NoSQL is not transactional. then it has to move to some sort of an RDBMS or OLTP system, where I cannot, correct. So, because that is actually fetching from their DB, because it's a transaction. And there all your asset and everything has to come. You can't just take a guess. And if million people do that, it will be slow. Definitely slow. There is no other way for that. That is where there it will fail. But initially, customer need to come, right?
Yeah. So basically, what is the challenges in working with streaming data? You have a storage layer and then you have a processing layer, right? So the problem with streaming data is that, so let's take Spark as an example, because anyway, we are going to use only Spark, right? So in Spark, what is the challenge? The first challenge is that how do you get the data? Streaming data. For that, there are a lot of sources to get the data. So once you get the data, the second question is that how do you hold the data? Do you want to hold the data? If yes, how do you hold the data? How long do you want to hold the data? And how do you make it efficient? And accordingly, there are two types of processing. So let's say you are analyzing Twitter trends as an example. I want to know like which mobile phone is popular right now, something like that, right? So there I will be getting the streaming data that's from Twitter. I will be getting streams, but maybe I'm not interested in storing the tweets, right? Because I just want to know which mobile is trending right now. I don't want to store all the million tweets. Anyway, tomorrow I'm not going to get come back and analyze the tweet. Doesn't make any sense for me. So there I don't mind the storage layer. I don't want to store anything. I just want to keep the data, analyze it, and get some output. In some other cases, you want to store the data, like log files. You are getting web server logs and you want to analyze for intrusion or something. So there the logs will come in real time. You have to analyze it. At the same time, you also need to keep a copy. You can't just delete the log files. And after that, after a month, if somebody has to come back and check the logs should be stored. So there you need to find a way where you can analyze it. And at the same time, you should be able to store the original copy also. So there we had used Flume in one example. Okay, the same example I can modify. So this sensor data, right? So normally, what is our architecture? Flume will get the sensor data and send it to Spark, right? The problem is Spark will process here and then do something and store it into Hive, but my original sensor data is gone. This will apply some logic, extract some keywords and all. So my original data is gone. So I don't want that. I want the original data to be stored somewhere. That is where in Flume, okay? In Flume, you can do something called multiplexing. I can do something called multiplexing in Flume, where I will have one source. So remember Flume, you have a source, channel and a sink, right? The source is my IoT data for sure. So I will get the data. Then I will have two channels. I will have a channel one and a channel two. This channel will send to Spark. This channel will send to HDFS. This is called multiplexing. But I am using two channels. It's like almost duplication. Point to point in the sense it is point to point only. If this was Kafka, I need only one line, right? But if this was Kafka, I needed one topic where everybody can read. But in Flume, this is actually duplication. Same data is duplicated in two channels. So what is channel? Actually, it is your memory. Channel is nothing but your memory. So I'll be using double the memory, but one section I can send to Hadoop, the original log file. Another pipeline will go to Spark.
Copy.
But that way, I can store the golden copy of my data. The original log files also I can store, or IoT data also I can store. Spark will process the other part of the data as well. So this is the solution if you are using Flume. Redundant copies will be there. So this copy will go to directly HDFS, no change. This copy will be consumed by Spark. But the problem is that now Flume need double the resources to run. Because initially I had only one pipeline, now I have two pipelines. Right, so better will be Kafka here, but I'm saying there are a lot of companies who implement only Flume in this example. So I have to use something called multiplexing. That is the only way to do it, right? So this is challenges. And the second biggest problem is that batch processing and real-time processing together. Okay, so that is very confusing also. So like in the credit card fraud detection, right, example, customer made a transaction. I caught the transaction. I want to know whether it is fraud. Now, one way to look at is that by the amount or something. But always, I want to analyze his previous transactions, okay, and what he did so far. Okay, probably in the last 100 transactions, he was transacting from Chennai. All of a sudden, he is transacting from Japan. So that means there is a probability of fraud there. So how do you compare or how do you bring batch and real time together? The processing, right? So there also Spark Streaming is very efficient. Spark Streaming can combine batch and real time together. Real time processing it will do. At the same time, if you have some batch data, it can query that or process that and combine the results. That is possible. And the second important point here is that when you say batch and real time together, other frameworks are very bad. Like Storm, I told you, right? So Storm cannot actually process batch data. Data which is already stored, not like real time data. So like I said, and the biggest example of all this is coming in when you do machine learning and all, right? So let's say you build a machine learning model, okay? And so you could have done a training on the data, right? That is how you do machine learning, right? Then you create what? A model, right? So you have a model. Now that model can predict. That is why you create a model. So that is batch. That entire thing is batch. Because how did you train it? Using what? Old data, right? And the model is ready. So probably you have trained the model using all the credit card transactions of all the employees or all the customers of the bank for last 10 years. That is your model. But now that model has to be taken real time. Because now you start getting real time transactions, credit card transactions. They are coming. So I have to take this machine learning model in real time, right? So when you were learning machine learning, how were you testing your model? So how do you test it is working or not? Fine. So that is batch. That's what I'm saying. So it will predict, but the data is already there, right? But what if I'm telling you that create a machine learning model, fine, for predicting credit card fraud. You already got some data, you predicted everything. Now I'm saying that take this model to real time. That's not possible. With machine learning, I'm saying directly it is not possible. How do you feed the data? That's not possible, right? So since Spark is also having this MLlib library, machine learning library is there inbuilt in Spark, right? It's very easy. You develop all the algorithm inside that, and you can just call that model within Spark Streaming. So Spark Streaming will feed all the data to your machine learning model. It's going to predict in real time. It is having. So that depends on the versions, actually. So now we are in 2.3. So it is having a lot of improvements in 2.3. There are multiple libraries which can cater. And almost all the algorithms are supported. Probably what we'll do, we'll discuss. I have discussed with your trainer also. We'll discuss that tomorrow. He will also help you with some PySpark examples and how can you basically call machine learning models and all. But yes, because otherwise it is quite useless, right? If I'm saying that the Spark can do machine learning and if it can do only basic stuff, then practically there is no use. So majority of the industry is doing this. They will build machine learning models. They could have learned it. And that model is static or what you say, batch, right? Now, how do you take it in real time? So you start Spark Streaming. And since Spark Streaming is just a library in Spark, it can communicate with any other library, Spark SQL or RDDs or anything. It can just say that dot predict and call your model, pull the model. The model will work in real time. And that is how you predict. So otherwise, how this is possible? Or if you have to give me an alternate solution, how will you do? That's my question. Possible. But this is much more efficient, actually, in terms of Spark. That's what we were using, like, as a service most of the time, machine learning as a service, right? Is there any specific tool that you people use for that? So that is possible. And So this does not mean like before Spark, we were using this thing. Mahood was doing that, but the problem was that Mahood was a bit slow. Mahood was the, because machine learning was already there. It's not something new. And Mahood was able to build all these things, all these algorithms. Mahood is even there today. It has improved a lot, right? So so I was actually working as an architect when we implemented this this thing. Citibank, we had this Storm cluster,
So I was not into development of machine learning or anything. So there they were running Mahout for predictions. Mahout was predicting at that point in time. And they had a very large cluster actually. So they were able to almost get enough speed of predictions and recommendations and whatever they wanted to do. Almost, because the data that is coming in real time is handled by Storm. Storm came long back, 2008, almost 2008. So at that point in time, so before that they were not doing this, I don't think. Like before 2008 or 2007, I don't think this much real time detection and fraud was not there. Or they could have been doing using some other manual technique. But after that, the first thing which came was Storm. Then we got something called Flink. Flink and Spark Streaming are very similar. Okay. Now there is one more catch. So when I explain, I should say everything, right? Even when you say real-time analysis, there are two types of analysis. One is event-based. It is called CEP, Complex Event Processing. One is event-based analysis. Second is time-based. So you have event-based and time-based. What is the difference? Storm is event-based. That means it can catch an event in real time and do something. So somebody swiped a credit card, that single swipe is an event for Storm. That's good. Spark is time-based. Spark actually does something called micro-batching, meaning it is not catching a credit card transaction. It will catch for a time. So when we do streaming in Spark, we will say that, okay, create streaming and the interval is 1 second. That means it will collect all the data in 1 second and apply whatever processing you want. So in 1 second, 1,000 credit card transactions might happen, one might happen. It doesn't know. Spark cannot do event-based real time. So that has to be clarified, right? Otherwise, everybody will say that everything is real time. No. So the real time is what Storm is doing. Because it can catch even a single event and process. That's good actually, right? But with Spark, like I have seen Spark from 1.3, 1.3 onwards version. So in 1.3, 1.4, 1.6 and all, the minimum interval was 1 second. Even in 2, interval was 1 second. In 2.3, latest version, they have reduced to 1 millisecond. So 1 millisecond is very small. That means if you start sending the data, it will chop into 1 millisecond, 1 millisecond, 1 millisecond batches and process it. It is actually batch processing, but in real time. So what Spark does as a real-time analytics is actually batch processing. Meaning when you say that, hey Spark, analyze all the tweets or predict which is the trending player, what it does, the data will come and you have to mention something called batch interval. So if I mention batch interval as 3 seconds, it will chop your data to 3 second, 3 second, 3 second batches as and when it comes. And whatever analysis you are doing will happen on this 3 second window. So you are not analyzing one tweet, you are analyzing tweets within 3 seconds window. That's called micro batching. Spark is actually doing micro batching. It is not a complete real time processing. Yes. So if you start getting data from now onwards, let's say 10 o'clock you start your processing. The first output will come at 10:03. 10 o'clock, 1 minute, 3 seconds. Because 3 second data it will collect and whatever analysis you wrote it will apply, show you the output. Again, next 3, next 3, next 3. If it is 3 second, you can also make it 1 second and with Spark 2.3 it can be 1 millisecond. So 1 millisecond is almost real time, but still it is not event based. Storm is event based. It can take, so in Storm you won't say collect like 10 second data. You will say every event you analyze and tell me. Flink is also this thing, event based. But event based is not so important these days. Like if you're getting a batch of like 1 second or less than 1 second, that's okay. Next thing, let me ask you one question. You are getting the data, that is one thing. You are processing the data is different thing. So I'm saying 1 second is my interval. In 1 second, 10 tweets can come, 10 million tweets can come, correct? So if you're getting 10 million tweets in 1 second, just a hypothetical figure, you are getting, your batch size is 1 second. So that means every 1 second you will chop your data.
Every 1 second you are getting what? 10 million tweets. To analyze that, you are taking 5 minutes. You are getting data every 1 second. Okay. So once you get the 1 second data, you should analyze it. You are not just getting the data, right? So 1 second you are getting 10 million tweets. Okay. So 1 second data you got, let's say 10 o'clock. You analyzed it, some complex algorithm ran. At 10 o'clock, 5 minutes, the output of that data comes. So whether you're doing Storm or Spark or anything, the biggest challenge is how you cope with the incoming data and the processing time. They are different, right? The data coming in is different. The processing time is different. So if you are showing the output of data coming at 10, at 11, still Spark is good because it is giving you data in real time. It is your problem, right? Because the processing is taking so long. So there you will have a lot of troubles. So that is where you adjust. You have to understand how much data will come in a particular time interval. And then what should be your batch interval? Should I keep very small, very big, right? Because otherwise it doesn't make any difference, right? Because the amount of data that you process also matters. So Spark does something called micro batching. That is my whole point. It is time-based streaming. It's not event-based. On the other hand, Storm and all are event-based processing. But anyway, Spark is as good as real-time now. This is what I was saying. So using MapReduce, I mean, this is a very weird example. Like day one data you are processing on day two. Like this is batch processing. Day one you are collecting some data. You are processing that data on day two. Again, day two data you are processing on day three. That is what MapReduce is doing. What Spark is doing, day one data you can process on day one itself, or as in when the data comes, you can process. Like, weird example, but maybe serve the purpose, right? Batch and real time. Yeah, so this is the basic difference. So batch is like queries or processing over all or most of the data in the data set. Stream is queries or processing over data within a rolling window. So when you say batch processing, you will analyze the full data mostly. Like if I have to run a SQL query on a table, let's say I'm running a very complex query, I will load the whole data and query the data. But when I say real time, only that window matters. I want to know the famous player every minute. So every minute only you need to process. I don't have to process the whole data, right? Data size, here it is very large. Here it is individual record or micro batches. Performance, in minutes to hours, here it is milliseconds. Analyze complex, here it is simple response functions, aggregates and rolling metrics. So the next thing is that when you are actually doing streaming analytics, your analysis will not be so complicated. You can make it complicated, but then it will take processing more time, all right? So, but I think machine learning and all, once you build an algorithm, I don't know, it may not take much time to, then that delay actually will matter. Because it has to recommend, right? Then only you can do something. So either you need to have enough resources to run that. I believe when you're running it in a cluster and all, it'll make a difference. So machine learning, when you're actually running in a single laptop or something, compare that with when you're running in a distributed cluster, probably even if with the features, it might be faster, I believe. Otherwise, these companies may not be able to do all this kind of analytics, right? Okay. When you say local traffic, right? The bus routes and all. Very much, because the amount of data it has to crunch, so many people are there, right? Everybody will be using, let's say, public transport, and the amount of data it has to crunch. Google is responsible, right? I mean, Google is the one who is showing, right? You can expect a delay. So it depends on your use case also. Like you are doing things like, we were extensively working on this, what you call sentiment analysis. So you have this sentiment analysis, right? It's very popular. Like you get the data and then you predict how a particular product the customer will like or they don't like. So we had an Australian customer, okay? So they were about to sell one particular brand of whiskey, okay? So they want to sell whiskey basically in Australia and they want to do sentiment analysis. Meaning, they want to know what people will think about whiskey, whether they will actually buy whiskey or not whiskey, these things, right? So for that, what we do, we collect the data. So that's not 100% real time, but we collect the data, even in real time, and then we will extract the individual words and match them with certain keywords. And then we will be able to predict whether the customer actually might use. So there, once their product went online, this entire system we migrated to real-time. The next challenge is, if you are building the same real-time system, so previously what people used to do, let's say they have Storm. So what Storm is doing? Storm is doing real-time data. It will give you real-time data. But Storm does not have machine learning. So what people used to do, they used to build their own machine learning model and incorporate it with Storm. That is possible. But the drawback is, if something needs to be changed, right, in the model or anywhere, everything has to be rewritten and reconfigured inside it, because they are totally different things. Storm is different and the machine learning libraries are different. But when you're actually using Spark, it doesn't matter, because everything is an RDD end of the day, right? So on the fly, you can modify the code, even machine learning. Unified API, right? You can do anything. So you don't have to make or break any code, existing code itself. So integration is very important. So I think so far Spark is the only framework where you have this capability. Like, you can natively integrate machine learning with Spark streaming. Flink also supports, but I'm not 100% sure how much it supports machine learning. Not 100%. Spark is the only framework so far. So anyway, that's the comparison. And originally we were using MapReduce. I'm not going to do that. So many environments require processing same data in live streaming as well as batch processing, right? Existing framework cannot do both. Either do stream or do batch, right? So that is only possible. And I will talk about this fault tolerance in a different slide. So one of the important topics in Spark streaming is how it is fault tolerant. Like, if something crashes, how will you recover, right? So I have a separate set of slides for fault tolerance. So this is only one slide, and this may not serve it. I will talk about it separately. And that is where we got Spark, right? So I don't have to talk much about Spark, right? So Spark streaming is the extension of core Spark API. And it is scalable, high throughput, and fault tolerant, low latency processing, simple batch-like API. It is for use cases which require a significant amount of data to be quickly processed. Now, one thing that I have to tell you is that if you Spark, problem is that normally when people teach Spark streaming, they will say, okay, there is something called Spark streaming, which is nice, you know, it can process the data. But if you look at the documentation, it will say Spark streaming is legacy. Like, Spark streaming is gone. Now in every my class, this happens, right? I will teach something and say that people are not using it. But so if I look at latest Spark documentation, if I scroll down, what is Spark streaming? Old API. This one, this Spark streaming is old API. Now, there is a catch. There is something called Spark streaming which came originally, and that is what we are learning. And wherever I have gone, everybody is still using Spark streaming. The original what we are learning. There is something called structured streaming. This is what the new thing. It's not very new. It came with Spark 2. Okay. Structured streaming is nothing but you are integrating Spark streaming with Spark SQL. Spark streaming and Spark SQL. So the problem with the original Spark streaming is you can do real-time processing and all, no problem. But where will you store the outputs? So once I processed my data, so let's say I'm getting a lot of real-time data, I applied some logic, I processed the data, okay, and then I have to store it somewhere. So I store it in Hive or something like that normally. Then it is fine, but there are many requirements where I have to store the data also, like this, let's say the sensor statistics and all, right? So what structured streaming allows you to do is that when you create a stream in structured streaming, it will create a data frame automatically. And this data frame will keep on getting appended with the data, which means in real time, you can write streaming SQL queries. It's a bit confusing. I will not get into that right now. It is like you have an ever-growing table. You have a table. The table grows every 1 second. You got the idea, right? Now you can query that table with a time frame. In streaming. That is structured streaming. Now I recommend you to read a bit there are a lot of YouTube videos also. If you go to Spark Conf in YouTube, because Spark recommends to use it now. That is why they are marking it as old. Your syllabus has only this. Now, I don't mind teaching this, but we will not be able to finish it because it is much more complicated also and requires much more time. But I must tell you that this is happening in the industry, right? At least. Well, otherwise, I can just say, okay, Spark streaming. Then tomorrow you go to the industry and people talk about structured streaming. You don't know. So structured streaming is, and it has much more fault tolerance and all. That's a different story. But the basic idea is that the moment you start your streaming data, it will create an infinite, ever-growing data frame or a table. And so you can run streaming queries every time. And there is something called a result set that will keep on changing, like 3 seconds, 3 seconds, like that. You can run queries as and when the data comes, and then you can do something. So basically, the problem was that people were not able to use SQL queries directly on legacy streaming. So legacy streaming will not allow you to query the data in motion. The data will come in motion, and then you analyze it and dump it in a Hive table, then you can query. That's a different thing. But here in structured streaming, the data as it is in motion, you can query from your data frame. And once the data is in the form of a data frame, you can do many things. You know that, whatever you want. You can visualize the data and all. So, but once we complete this, please spend some time on structured streaming. Once you understand normal Spark streaming, structured streaming will not be much of a headache to you. You can read and understand even that. Okay. So that's what I'm saying. So when you look at the documentation also, I should do justice to that also, right? So these are the connectors. So here is where your interesting topics come, right? So Spark streaming supports following input data sources. The first question is that how are you going to get the data? From where will you get the data? I want real-time data. Who is going to give me? One way is Kafka. So if you have Kafka installed, and if the data is coming in a Kafka topic, Spark streaming can get the data from Kafka. Yes, we will discuss Kafka separately. And also in Kafka, there are a lot of changes now. Again, with my little experience, there are a lot of changes because I have a separate slide for Kafka and Spark integration, Spark streaming integration. Wherever people are using Spark streaming, majority use cases are with Kafka. Majority of them will be using some Kafka implementation. So I will talk about Kafka in depth, but yes, from Kafka, you can create a stream. We will do that. Second is Flume. So Flume, like I said, can be the Flume sync can send the data to Spark. Third, we will not do this, but there is something called a text file stream, meaning on HDFS or Amazon S3, if you have a folder, Spark streaming can monitor that folder. And whenever if a file is being placed in that, it can read it. So that way you can create a stream. So that is the third way. This is Kinesis. Kinesis is an Amazon Web Services product, proprietary AWS, but very popular these days. I have worked on Kinesis a little bit. Because if your cluster is in Amazon, the best way to get streaming data is Kinesis. So I'll talk a little bit about Kinesis. Basically, it allows you to give streaming data. That's what it does, like Kafka, very similar. But this is proprietary, works only on Amazon Web Services, right? Twitter for sure, TCP sockets. TCP sockets means it can monitor a port and get the data. We will do that. Like in your laptop, you open a port and let's say somebody is sending some data. Spark streaming can monitor that port and get the data. One more thing is that wherever I have worked in Spark streaming, I have used only Scala. Python is not preferred for Spark streaming. Ideally, our examples are in Python. That's fine. We can do examples, but in reality, when you go, the reason why I'm saying this is that this custom connectors, the last option is custom connector. Like you can create your own connector for getting the data. If you want to do that, I don't think in Python you can write it. Only Scala is supported so far for custom connectors. So let's say you have an application which is sending data, and Spark streaming should want to directly get the data from that application. So you should write your own connector for that. And I don't think in Python it is supported. Also, performance-wise, Python has a lot of drawbacks when it comes to Spark streaming. So wherever I have seen the production code, it is all in Scala. our code is in Python. That will also run. For learning purpose, it is good. But when you go to production, Scala code is preferred for streaming, especially. Output can be persisted either in HDFS or database or a dashboard or anywhere. So once you have the output, it is as good as an RDD. You can say save to Cassandra or in a UI or anywhere you want. This doesn't matter, right? Yes, there is a Mongo Spark connector, which we use. We have used a Mongo Spark connector. So using that, you can push to MongoDB collection. So in MongoDB, you have an idea of what, you have a database, then you have something called a collection. Collection is like a table. Then you have a document. Document is like a row, right? So the only thing is that when you start the Spark shell, you have to mention the URI where MongoDB is running. And what is the collection name, DB name? And then there is a Mongo Hadoop and Mongo Spark connector that if you use, it can push directly. So these are the outputs. This is a partial output. It just says Cassandra, okay? So this is just a pictorial representation of the same thing which I was talking about. No difference at all, right? Spark Streaming can use all the core APIs like data frames, RDDs. So another advantage is that from within Spark Streaming, you can access other libraries like RDD, for example, right? So if you have, that is where batch and real-time can combine together, right? So let's say you're writing the Spark code, you already have some data stored somewhere, okay? You can say write a SQL query and the output of the SQL query, I can join with a Spark Streaming data that I have. So you are practically joining batch data with real-time data. That is possible. So it can access all the libraries that we have. Scala, Java, and Python are supported. R, I don't think. You have done R? R language is done, complete. So in R, what you learn, I mean, not in the language, like what you do with R, I'm asking. I'm interested. Huh? So all these models, you are doing regression, this, that, everything can be done in R. Either you can use Python or you can use R, right? Okay. Because R, this is the example of what I was telling, right? So you are getting the data, Spark Streaming data, right? The MLE will be your trained models with live data. You can also use trained model. It can also do real-time learning. Real-time learning is possible if the data is so huge, right? Because you are getting a huge amount of data. Real-time learning, you're training the model, right? Live data. So that is what this part, train models with live data. You will already have a model which is already trained. It's not like from scratch. But whatever data you are receiving can be used to enrich your model, right? Because you are getting huge amount of data that can be used to enrich your models. Or you can use trained model. Already somebody has trained a model. I just want to call it. That's also possible. Build the two models in your example using PySpark. MLib, basically. Because otherwise, you are doing only Python. So if you want to integrate your Spark knowledge and machine learning. So he said, OK, tomorrow I'll do that. I will use PySpark rather than simple Python. So then you will also understand how PySpark is or MLlib is actually being used in this scenario. I just spoke about it. And the data can be processed with data frames and you can query with SQL. That is also possible. Now, the real-time queries are supported in structured streaming only. Like as and when the data comes, you want to query, you have to use structured streaming, but it is possible. you can dump it into Elasticsearch or Kafka or Cassandra or any place you want. These are the streaming data sources, right? Kafka, Kinesis, Flume, Akka, and Anna, of course. HBase, Cassandra, Akka Scala, Scala product, Cassandra, and so many other static sources, right? So n number of sources. Anybody worked on Akka? Akka is a very popular, you have worked. So once this Spark job is done, you will clean up some data on that journal. So I think we can get started, right? We will start with the hands-on, right? So first, what we will do that Twitter analysis, right? We will get the data from Twitter, and then we will run Spark Streaming on it, and then we will analyze the data. A very basic example. And what I prefer to do is like, I will do it first, the example, okay? So that way you can concentrate on what I'm doing and then make sure, and I will also make sure it will work once we ran it. And then I will give you some time to do it by yourself. It won't take much time for you to execute because the code is actually in this notebook, IPython notebook. So you don't have to do any modification actually, it will work, right? But it will be better. And the second problem is that if all of us start doing together, if I don't know whether the amount of data that will be consumed will be very high. So I will initially do alone just to make sure things are working and what you are doing, right? And then we will move to you can practice. I'll give you some time for you to definitely practice, right? So usually after that we give the lab assignment. In normal real-time classes, what we do is that after Twitter streaming I'll give the lab question and then the class is over. But today what we will do, I will show you that other case study, EMR case study, Amazon EMR case study, after this is done, right? So that will take around 1 or 2 hours probably to run the case study. So that you will not be able to do along with me because it is on EMR, but I will show and guide you with everything. And so once class is done, you can set it up and just practice it. No, EMR is not free. It's a paid setup, but it is not like too costly. I mean, it is on Amazon. So when you are running on Amazon, they will charge you, but very less. Let's say like 30 rupees, 20 rupees per 2 hours or 3 hours. And you will not be running it forever. So normally when you run EMR, you will run it for an hour or two and then you terminate. Like, so you will be getting charged only that much. It's very cheaper actually. Now, again, I should say that if you have a concern on cost, you are free not to try that. I mean, I'm just saying in case if people are concerned, okay, I'm paying something, but there is no way you can get a free EMR cluster. Everything is paid in EMR, right? So there will be minimum charges, but very, very minimum. I can show you the pricing also. They charge very minimum actually for EMR, but that will be a good practice, I think, to do that, because many organizations are actually using EMR now for processing the data. So if you can at least run it once, then that will give you a good idea, right? And also probably somewhere you can say that, yeah, I have actually created an EMR cluster, probably in your resume or wherever you're saying, you can say, I have at least seen what is EMR, what it is capable of doing. Basic at least, right? So what we are going to do is here in the slide. So what is the objective of this demo? How can you process live tweets for trend analysis using Spark Streaming API? That's what we are going to do, right? We will show how to use Twitter API and route tweets coming from the Twitter to a TCP server using Socket Stream. TCP server is hosted in the local machine. In our case, it is CloudX Lab. So I must tell you about the architecture a little bit. Otherwise, the demo will not be complete. So the point I'm telling is that normally when somebody want to do reliable Twitter streaming, Twitter will be there, that is for sure. They have an API. So Twitter has an API, it's called Twitter Firehose. Through that, it will give you the tweets. Now this part is easy. Like in the Flume example also, if you remember, we downloaded tweets. Same thing, through this also you can get the tweets. The question is, who is getting the tweet, right? So like I said, most of my experience is in Scala with the Spark, okay? So there what we do is that there is a Spark and Twitter jar file which you can use, to Twitter jar file. So if I use that Twitter jar file, if I have a cluster, I have a method, I can say that Twitter utilities dot create stream. There is a method, create stream. So if I call this method, what will happen is that I will start a receiver here. I will have a receiver here, okay? And this guy will directly connect with Twitter API. This is in Scala. In the Scala code, you can use a third-party jar file, okay? That jar file has Twitter methods actually available. So once you import that jar files,
there is a method called a Twitter utilities dot create stream. So in that dot create stream, you will pass the arguments. What is your ID, your API credentials? You will pass, and then you say create the stream. So what that will do, it will start a receiver here, and directly this receiver will start getting the tweets from Twitter. So your receiver is normally talking to Twitter API. So this is not what we are doing. In Python, it doesn't work like that. In Python, what we are doing is, so this is, if you are running in production, you have to set up a separate machine. And here my Python code will run. This is not PySpark code, normal Python code. And in this Python code, I have a library called TweePy, which I can import in Python. TweePy, which will allow me to communicate with Twitter and get the tweets. So TweePy is a library which you can add your API credentials and normal Python code. So Python code will get you the Twitter data, right? But then what will happen? This will start getting the tweets, okay? And I will open a port number here. I'll start a port here. You can open a socket. So that means these tweets will hit this socket. And in the Spark cluster, I will do socket stream. Meaning, I will monitor this port, whatever. So through this, I will start getting the tweets. So these two architectures are different because here you are not receiving the data through any port number. You are directly talking to Twitter and saying that give me the data. And Twitter Firehose will give you to your receiver. You start getting the data. In our Python example, it is not possible that directly you go to Twitter and say that give me the data. So what we do is that we'll first run a Python code by importing the TweePy library that will start receiving the data. Like it will start pulling all the tweets. You can see the real tweets coming in. And then I will open a port number and that tweets will hit this port number. And here on my Spark cluster, I will say that sse.create socket stream. I want to monitor a port number. And what is a port number? This port number. So naturally all the tweets are here. It will start getting to my cluster and then you will process. Okay. This is not so good, but this is also a way. So usually Python developers does like this. Scala developers does like that. Now in both these architectures, the drawback is if, let's say, in this architecture, the drawback is if the receiver crashes, then you will lose the tweets. In this architecture, if this guy crashes, then your tweets are gone, right? So if you are really doing some serious sentiment analysis or something, you bring the data to Kafka. You make Kafka in the middle. You bring the tweets to Kafka. From Kafka, you consume. So that you can consume to Python code or Scala code or any code, you know, because you're talking to Kafka there. But as of now, we are not integrating Kafka in this example. We are just seeing how we can get the live tweets. And since we are using the cloud lab, this machine will be inside the lab only. This is one of the lab machine. So one of the lab machines, I will open a port, right? And that machine will start getting all the Twitter data. And I will ask Spark Streaming to monitor that port, get the tweets, process it. That's what basically what we are doing, okay? So it is written here. So see the third point, route tweets coming from Twitter API to TCP server. So we will set up a TCP server, we'll open a socket and say that, hey, all the tweets which are coming, come through this port number using socket stream. So this is an alternative method to Kafka, Kinesis, Flume and all. So you remember using Flume, we pulled the data, right? And actually from Flume, when you're pulling the tweets, you can say that go to Spark, that is possible. But we will just try the socket file stream this way. So TCP server is hosted in the local machine. In our case, it is CloudX Lab machine. Okay. Right. And I think this part is already something which you already know, how to access the Twitter API, right? You will register with apps.twitter.com, right? And then you will get your consumer key, consumer secret, access token and access token secret, right? These four things you will generate. After creating the app, you will get this. You will also need to generate access token and access token secret. Now we are ready to call Twitter API. So this part is already done as part of your Flume example, right? Even here it is done. Now what we should do, right? Okay. So I will, like I said, I will try this first. I will definitely give it to you, but I think I have to upload the Okay, so two notebooks are there. One is called Get Twitter Streams. The other is called Hash Trends. Now, the next question is like, what are you going to do with the tweets? So you will be getting tweets, that's fine. But what are you going to do with the tweets? So what we will do, once we get tweets in real time, we will filter the tweets for hashtags. You know hashtag, right? Starting with hash. We will extract only the hashtag from the tweet related to a topic, and then we will count the most popular hashtags in a window, particular window, say 10 seconds or 20 seconds related to a topic. So this analysis is what we are doing, right? Now to do that, first what we need to do is that you need to have a small idea. So this is how a tweet will look like on this left hand side. Can you see what I pasted? This is how a tweet will look like when it comes from Twitter. Okay, one tweet, how it looks like. So as you can see, it is having JSON format. Okay, JSON means key value pair, right? So lot of keys are there, right? In which there is a key called text. This is the actual tweet that the person is tweeting. So here you can see, in preparation of the NFL lockout, blah, 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 something. This is the actual tweet he's doing. Then rest all the key values are sort of like metadata of the tweet. For example, you have in reply, ID, user mentions, then what you have, any URLs mentioned, whether it was retweeted, retweeted count, created it. So all this is metadata. And again, then there is another text. So this is another tweet. Okay, probably repeated. Okay, so the point is, when you are looking at a tweet, you have to extract this, text part. Text is where actually if somebody is writing. So this is a text part. So this is what we need to extract. So our logic in PySpark or Spark Streaming will be that we will get this part and then we will split it. And then we'll search for any word that is starting with a hash. That will be a hashtag. And then we will just count it and sort it and then print it. That is a logic we are using. Okay. So this is a sample tweet. It will come in proper JSON format. Right? So here you can see a couple of tweets more. And you will also have this screen name. So this is a Twitter user screen name. Whether the Twitter profile is verified, false. Whether he has mentioned any time zone, null. Friends count, 21. Language, English. Favorite count, 0. Right? Profile color, name. All these are metadata. So like some 50 plus keys are there. And we are interested only in the actual tweet. Right? So, but when you say that create a socket stream, all of this will come. So the processing is a lot actually. This is one tweet, right? So, and when you say, give me all the real-time tweets, a lot of tweets will hit and they all come in this format, like JSON format. So that processing part Spark will do. We don't have to worry, right? So this is how the tweet will look like. And okay, so there are two notebooks which you have to use. One is called Get Tweets in Real-Time using Twitter API. So this will help you to just get the tweets, okay? And then start a TCP server on a particular port number and make sure the tweets are there. The second one is trend analysis. So this is the Spark Streaming code where it will monitor that port and whatever analysis we just discussed, it will do there, right? Okay, so let's get started. I think, but we are running them in what? So it should not be Python, right? Now, like this guy can be in Python, we don't mind, but this guy has to be in this one. We have to run it in PySpark code. Okay. And this one can be in your local Python 3 code. Does not matter. We will just check how it runs anyway, and then we will see. So first thing that we are doing here is that we will import a library called a TweePy. So TweePy is a Python library, which is designed to communicate with Twitter. All your API credentials can be taken. And so we are using TweePy library to route all the live tweets to a TCP server. The server is hosted in cloud. So we have to import the TweePy library first. So first I will say import TweePy. And within TweePy, you have this
OAuth handler. So when you are communicating with Twitter, you have this consumer key, consumer secret. They are handled by this authentication. So you are importing that package for authentication. So I'll just say import the package. And if you go to the slides, what it says is that first step is creating the Twitter broker. So the broker is a Python client which connects to Twitter using TwiPy library and forward all the tweets to Spark Socket Stream via TCP listener. So you don't have to do this like installing TwiPy, it's already done. But let's say you are building a new setup, then you have to say pip install TwiPy, right? This is what you need to do, right? And then what you need to do once you import the OAuth handler, you are also importing something called a stream, and within stream you have something called stream listener. Okay, so this is used to listen to all the Twitter streams that are coming in. Okay, and after that you have something called socket and JSON. The socket library is used to start a TCP server on a particular port number that you want. JSON is imported because we want to analyze the data. So the data will be actually coming in JSON format and you want to talk to that. That is why you are importing the JSON package, right? Now what you do to connect to Twitter API, you have these keys. So when you are actually running this example, use your own keys, okay? So this has a different set of keys, but I'm just saying that this is my consumer key, consumer secret, access token, and access secret. So these are my four credentials, right? After this, what we are doing here is, we will define a class. So this is one way of doing it, okay? There are other ways to do it also. We will define a class called a tweet listener, and it is using this stream listener, okay? And why are we defining this class? See, it is listening to the stream via stream listener. So it has a constructor, if you are aware of object-oriented programming and all. It will initialize this socket, okay? And the Twitter data in the JSON format will come to the stream. And within the data, you have, within the JSON object, you have a key called a text that will have the actual tweet, okay? And the actual tweet is extracted and sent to the client socket. Error handling is also done. So what this whole class is doing is very simple. It uses the stream listener, okay? And then what happened? I have a constructor, okay? I have a socket in the constructor, okay? So the C socket is my socket, okay? And once I get the data, what I will do is that I will have a try except. So this is exception handling, right? I will say JSON.loads data. So data, whatever is hitting, will be read by JSON, parsed by JSON. Within the data, I will say print message text.encode UTF. So I'm doing a print statement here. So this is how you understand whether you're getting the tweets. When I run this code, if this guy gets the data, okay, it will start printing all the tweets one by one on your terminal. Otherwise, you don't know whether it is actually receiving it, okay? You can also print other lines if you want. That's up to you, but we are not doing that anyway. Like, text is one key. If you want to print all the created at the user's names, all these things you can print. We are not doing that. Self is an object we use, right, in Python. So even, have you done MapReduce using Python? Self, how do I explain? It is just an object used to handle whatever values you are, you know, defining in your class normally. I will explain about it, okay? So once you return, what are you returning? You will send the text. Text is the key and the encoding is UTF-8. Whatever tweets you have, you will send it. You will say return true. And this part is all exception handling. So if there is any exception comes, error on data or the data is not coming, this part is full exception handling. This class basically what it does is that it will just receive your through stream listener. It will receive your tweets, okay? And whatever tweets are coming as data, it will be passed by JSON and it will just print the text part, okay? And the socket. So this self has a socket built in, right? So I will say that whatever tweets you are getting,
So because another requirement is that when you are getting the tweets, right, you will get the full tweet. But to the socket, I need to pass only the text. I don't need to pass all the keys, right? So that is what this client socket C socket does, right? So I will say return client socket dot send. So to that particular socket, we have to create a socket. Okay. To that particular socket, only the text part will be transferred. Okay. So this is what this code is doing. So in here, you have to define another function. Okay. So here is a function called, did we run this? No, right? Then I have a function called send data. So you're defining a function called send data, which will take this C underscore socket as an argument. Okay. So this auth is this authentication handler. So here you are passing your consumer key, consumer secret, access token, and access token secret. Right. And then you will say stream authler Twitter listener C socket. So what is going to happen? Where is this? Let me just scroll down. So here you have the class called Twitter listener. So when you are creating this stream, you are passing the authentication. You are also passing this Twitter listener, an instance of this Twitter listener, in brackets, the socket that you are having, right? And another thing is that when you actually start running this, it will start getting all the text part of your tweet, but you may not want to send everything. So what you do is that you can do a filter. You can say track something like Trump. So what is going to happen is that in the text part, all the tweets, if there is anywhere mentioning of Trump or anything related to Trump, it will filter only that and that will be sent. Otherwise, what is going to happen? All the tweets that you are downloading will be sent to the particular socket. So I will just run this function. We are just creating the function right now. And then you have to create your socket, right? So there is a function called a socket, which will create a socket object actually. So I'm saying that S equal to socket socket. This will create a socket. And as of now, what we are doing is that the host is localhost and take a random port. For example, here the port is 9877 and you have to say S dot bind and then host comma port. Now, if this works, there is an error. So what the error is saying is that it is saying that address already in use. So 9877 is already in use. What about 9999? So if the socket creation was successful, it will show that listening on port 9999. So right now that means this guy has started listening on 9999, right? And now what I will do is that I will say that s dot listen. Yeah. So look at this send data function. Where is the send data function? If I scroll up, this is the send data function, right? So what the send data function is doing is that it will create a stream. It will use your authentication credential and the tweet listener class you defined and pass the C underscore socket. It is going to filter the Trump keyword. And after that, what we did is that we defined the port number. This is a particular port number we have defined. Okay. And I just said S dot listen. And now in order to accept, what you need to do is that you have to simply say S dot accept. So this will establish the connection. And then what I'm doing, I'm just printing received request from, and I'm just printing this ADDR. So whatever tweets ideally I'm getting, it should start printing here in my console. So right now, nothing is been printing because it will take a moment to establish the connection and start printing. But after a moment, we should ideally start seeing the tweets coming in on the screen, right? So this whole process is actually only to get the data. You are just getting the data, only text part of it, filtering using a, say, keyword like Trump, and then just verifying that the tweets are getting printed. Now in the PySpark code, Spark streaming code, I will say create a streaming context, connect with this port, start getting the data, and then analyze and print the data, whatever is coming, right? So let's see whether it is actually giving any data right now. May take a moment for this guy to start getting the data. This star indicates what? This processing, right? So the above part, everything was working, and now it is actually listening and processing. So this will take a moment for that to start printing it online. Meanwhile, see what we are going to do with the PySpark library, right? So you are importing couple of libraries here. Okay, I will talk about this print function. First, there is Spark context, and then there is streaming context. So these libraries, so I will just import them. Okay, and this is how you are creating a Spark context, sorry, streaming context. You will say SSE equal to streaming context SC comma 10. So what is this 10 here? That is a batch interval. So you are saying that my batch is 10 second. So I need minimum 10 seconds worth data to process. So while creating the context, you are just mentioning your batch interval. That is nothing but 10 in this case. Okay. And then you will say that socket stream equal to SSC dot socket text stream. And what port we are monitoring? 9999, right? So what this line will do, it will establish a connection to localhost and start monitoring port number 9999, right? And window function parameter sets window length. All the analysis will be done on tweet stored for 60 seconds. So you can change this. So this is how you use windowing in Spark streaming. So now what you're saying is that, okay, 10 seconds is my batch interval, right? Which means it will start downloading data worth 10 second, 10 second, 10 second. And then I'm saying that socket stream dot window 60. So my window interval is what? 60 seconds. Then what is my slide interval now? So window interval is 60. What will be slide interval? Which one? This one is 60. The batch was 10. So sliding interval is when your computation should happen. That is sliding interval. Sliding interval will be 10 in this case, because you have not mentioned anything explicitly, right? In that case, what will happen? It will use the same batch interval, which means every 10 seconds, the computation will happen. My batch is same, sliding I have not mentioned, but it will calculate 60 seconds worth data for analysis. So initially, it will just pull whatever data it has, but ideally, let's say the streaming keeps on running, every 10 seconds, it will go back in time, last six batches or five batches, it will analyze and show you the result. So that's up to you to decide. I just use 60. We can even use a smaller number rather than 60. I can say 20 just to make it work. And then how do you process the team? So what is happening here? So once you get the data, what I do, I will do, so what is this part? I will do a flat map, and I will say that for every line, split it using space. And again, I'm using our functional programming, right? I will filter. I will say that take every word, convert the word to lower, and I want all the words that are starting with hash, right? That is how you get hashtags. Again, you will say map transformation, okay? Lambda word, word dot lower, comma one. So you will convert to key value pair, and then you will say reduce by key, A comma B, A plus B. So if you remember the word count we did, right? It's the same code. The only difference here is that I'm converting to lower sometimes, and I'm also filtering using a hashtag, starts with hash. Apart from that, this code is exactly same as your word count code, no difference at all. So you will say that I want to count the words, basically all starting with a hash. That is this piece of code doing. And let's make sure we run it. And once you get hashtags, what you do, there is a transform function. What the transform function will allow you to do is to operate on RDDs within the dstream. So normally the word count that we did is on the whole dstream. Okay, but if you want to access any RDDs within the dstream, you have to do transform. Because when you say that you are sorting the data, sorting means it has to happen within the dstream. If I say sort a dstream, nothing will happen, because dstream itself is one API, right? So I have to say that look at the RDDs you have within the dstream and then sort the hashtags. So that is why I'm saying hashtags dot transform, and I will say that lambda x dot sort by. What am I doing here? I'll just use the sort by function, and I will access the first element, convert to lower, and I will say that ascending false. That means descending. So the hashtags will come in hashtag comma the number. When you do the word count on the hashtag, it will have two parts. One will be the hashtag, let's say hash Trump, then the number like 3 or 5. So what am I doing here? I am saying that convert the key to lower, okay, and sort, run the sort function based on the value part, that is a number, in ascending false. Do you remember we did sorting in RDD programming? We use the sort by function and how to use sorting. Same thing you are doing here. So once you do this, which part did we run? Did we run this? I think we ran that, right? Which is pending? I mean, I don't remember. This is pending, right? Okay. So once we get it, the next thing will be that I just want to print it. Okay. And this is most important. So right now, okay, so there's already something coming up. Cell. Yeah. So right now, so far, nothing has happened. You just defined your D streams and you said, this is what I need to do, and so on and so forth. But in reality, nothing has happened so far, because if you want to start Spark streaming, you have to say ssc.start. And there is a method called ssc.await termination. I will talk about it. Okay. But just make a note that there is a method like this. So now, ideally, my streaming should start. So you can see that the streaming started, and we are getting data in 10 second interval. So it is like 10, 340, 10, 350. But were you running along with me? I mean, we can use the same keys multiple times, right? No. Then if you have started, then I will not get anything, right? Because the key is same. The Twitter key is different. But you're seeing the, not the port, the, this thing. Maybe I think that might be the reason. I'm not sure. No, port is changed for sure. I'm assuming if multiple connections are from the same key, will it allow? I don't know. Anyway, so what is this key? I think I'm not using my key. This is someone else's key. So can you guys try this? Anyway, we'll try together. So since it is not working and somebody said it is working, I got interested. Okay. Can we all try this together? I just want to check what is my key. So now I started getting tweets. Can you see tweets coming in? Can you see this? So this is all tweets. See? See how many are coming in? And then if I go to my Twitter analysis, can you see it is analyzing? So every 10 seconds, what will happen? Every 10 seconds, it will process a batch, right? And start showing me. So yes, so it is picking the last two batches and analyzing and showing you the output. The processing will happen every 10 seconds. Because your batch is 10 seconds, you have not mentioned any sliding window. So if you have not mentioned any sliding window, it will take it as batch interval. So it is 10 seconds now. So every 10 seconds, processing will kick in. But to process, it need two batches of data, 20 seconds worth data. So now it is 10:20, right? Yeah. It will analyze tweets from 10:00 and 10:10, 20 seconds worth data. That we cannot see, but it will just show. I mean, it won't. It will analyze 20 seconds worth data every time. So your sliding window is 10 seconds here. So what is happening? Every 10 seconds, you are getting data. And every 10 seconds, you are analyzing the data also. But you are not analyzing 10 seconds worth data. You are analyzing 20 seconds worth data. No, the analysis will happen every 10. You can see 9:50, then it will be next 10 seconds. I'll just show you here. Because I'm not able to scroll. If I scroll down, right? If I scroll down, you can see that now it is 11:30, right? What is the time? 11:30. And next analysis will happen at 11:40, right? Again, next analysis will happen at 11:50. So analysis will happen every 10 seconds. But in every 10 seconds, it is not analyzing 10 seconds worth data. It is analyzing 20 seconds worth data.
first it will not process. Like let's say it kicked off at 10 o'clock, it won't analyze anything. Because when it look behind, it will not have any data. Then 10 will come, still it will not process because it has only 10 second worth data. Next it will process because 20 second worth data it got. It starts processing that. So 20 seconds worth data every time it will process, but the processing will kick in every 10 second. 10 is your batch interval. Are you able to run this code and get something? There is one more problem. In the morning, Narayana also told me, PySpark is having some problem. I don't know what it is. Did he try to run code in PySpark and it didn't work? Correct. Then we ran it again. But again, PySpark was not able to access the file was there. But when the processing was happening, it was throwing error, some error. Even here, I'm facing the same problem because if you see, this is Python 3 code. It's not PySpark code. My Twitter analysis, right? This is running on what? Python 3. It should actually run on PySpark, right? In reality, this should run on PySpark code, right? We are importing, but normally the kernel has to be PySpark, ideally. That is a better way to run because you are directly accessing the libraries. But I don't know, I tried with PySpark, it was throwing some weird error. So I checked with Narayana, even he said he is also facing some issue, I don't know. Maybe they are doing something on the cluster. I'm not 100% sure. So make sure you can run this, you can execute the code. I was running in PySpark. I just switched to Python 3, it started working.
Okay, but this anyway, I'm running on Python 3 only.
You are in Python 3 only.
Yeah. But the other one is only on PySpark.
Okay, do one thing. You have to do send data also. And what you need to do, just start them. So stop it. I think it is running, right?
Yeah.
This is running, right?
Yeah.
How do you stop? There is a place to stop the server.
Yeah, you can just like this and then
Shut down. So now start it, but use Python only, Python 3 only. Don't use the PySpark kernel. That is having some problem. Even I'm not sure, like what is it? No, my question is, no, this is some old data. It is not working actually. This data is old. Old in the sense like already it could have had some data. So what you need to do and start them again. But this time run both in Python. Don't use PySpark. You were using PySpark for this thing, right? Now run it again, but make sure your port is correct. Like which port you are using? But here you have given a different port, okay? Here it was 9876. There also the port number has to be same. You can run that first, then this. So you need to change the port number in two places, okay? So some of the folks were doing like in getting the tweets, you will define a socket, right? And that should be same in the Spark streaming code also. Otherwise, it will not catch, right? So make sure your kernel is Python 3, just for the safer side. Then definitely it is not going to work. It is going to work. Yes, Spark streaming, you cannot stop. If you stop, you have to run all the cells again. The other guy, you can restart. So Spark streaming, so this is Spark streaming, hashtag trend. But now there is nothing. It is waiting for some time. Okay. So this thing, if I stop, I can stop this. But if I stop, I cannot say start. No. This thing, let it run. This thing, let it run. It will give you tweets. That's fine. This is where you're doing the analysis. This is Spark streaming. There you have to change. The other side, you don't have to change anything.
Okay, I understand.
You don't have to restart. Okay, you have to run that cell. Exactly. If you change the code, you have to run that cell again. But then you have to rerun all the cells. Wait. It is trying to get the port. Probably it will throw an error. Because last time we were using this port, maybe it is still bind. So it is running this cell, right? It will say whether that port is available or not. It will say that listening to that port, right? It will display that message, listening on port number. It was in this state only. Okay, then let it run. Maybe it is a bit slow to display. Next. Now here, here you can do one thing.
Okay, this is better, right? If you want to run everything, you can simply say restart and run all. So it will restart the kernel and run everything. Okay. And I'll just clear the output. I think it ran. I'm not sure. Let me check. No, it is running now. See? 4, 5, 6, 7. But my point is, it should ideally print here.
I agree, but last.
Okay, so here, it is running, but we are not seeing anything so far. And last time, were you able to see something here? Another question. When I gave you this file, these two files, it had some data already. So were you seeing that or were you seeing like live? Yes, yes, now it is empty. In my opinion, it is even stuck here. Stuck in the sense like it is trying to get data through this port, but it is not happening. That's why the star.
Last time also it was the same star.
Okay. Another thing is that everybody is trying. That also might have an impact because same machine, right? There is only one machine where all the ports you are jamming, right? We'll wait for some time. Probably it will get. Or else choose a different port maybe. Just change the port number to something else and rerun this. 420 is what? Error message, right? No. 420 will be given by Twitter, right? What is HTTP code 420? Can somebody check? It is client error, if I'm not. Can you check HTTP response code 420? I mean, I think that is it because you are getting 420. It's a client error HTTP. Because from the same machine, there is at least like 20, 30 requests going in, right? Probably that is the reason it is saying. Try one by one, it should work for sure. Return by version 1 of the Twitter search and trend API when the client is being rate limited. Rate limiting. Like, so 420 is an HTTP code for rate limiting when Twitter is rate limiting you. So there might be how many messages it can send to a particular client. So basically all of these people are running on single machine. Even though different port number, it's one machine. So they are rate limiting. They are saying we cannot send. So that is rate limiting, right? So some of you have to say, I will not run, then others can run. Obviously everybody is running, right? So it will rate limit you. Who is able to get the tweets? I mean, see the tweets. You're able to do. Okay. Who is able to get at least once? I mean, not like at least once you have seen, right? Who is not able to get at all? Twitter application is suspended. You got an error. Why? You search for something weird? No? That is client, this thing, right? Well, one more information is there. In Twitter, now if you open that app's website, apply for a developer account. I have applied, so maybe this will happen very easy, probably 24 hours or something. You are not eligible for developer access. Only one. Oh, it is already running one SSE. That is why this error is coming. I don't know where. Probably the previous one is not shut down. This one, right? These two notebooks, right? Let us pick a port number. No. This data will not be saved. It is streaming data. So it will come through that socket. Even the output is not getting saved. We are just seeing the output. If we want, we can say write it into Hive or somewhere if we want. But as of now, we are not doing that anyway. So I will probably, so that is the system time, the time in which that computer is running. This is running in the cluster, right? So in that cluster, this is servers are there, right? Their time is 10:10. So the current time is like 4 o'clock. But there the system time. But usually what we do is that's a good question, because if you are doing this kind of analysis like Twitter, last time Flume we did, right? So those times when you are in a cluster, we will enable this NTP service, network time protocol. Otherwise the machines will not sync. So you will have an NTP server that will sync all the machines to time zone, and then only you do all these things. Otherwise time is a very big problem. Especially when you are running Flume and all, throw error. If any one of the machine is not in sync with the time, it will throw error saying that there is time zone issue. So NTP you have to run if it is in a production cluster. Here it is just taking the system's time, local time, right? Okay, I'll just close this streaming for the time being. Now they have a mandate. So previously everybody was able to log on to Twitter, like apps.twitter.com, and say create an application. So that is being misused a lot, right? Because anybody can do anything. So now what they are asking us is there is an option to apply. Again, you go to apps.twitter.com. There is an apply button. There they will ask your mobile number, I don't know, some details. And then only they will approve. Otherwise, your account will be suspended. This app account, right? Port listening can be done in any system actually. So it is not the way you listen. I mean, what you process is different. Because in Spark, what you're doing is that you're listening to that port, and whatever data is coming in, you're chopping that to 3-second batches, right? Now, if that data is, let's say, very less, let's say you want to do the same sentiment analysis, okay? And if the data coming is very less, probably you don't need Spark to do it. Maybe you can write a Java code or something. You need to know the logic, what to do, right? How to extract and all. But Spark's relevance will come if that port is receiving too much data, which a normal machine cannot handle. It may crash. So in that case, what will happen is that whatever data you're coming in, it is distributing to the cluster. So that power it will get. And also, let's say you start receiving the data, but I want to analyze all the data came through that port number for last 1 hour, right? So my batch is last 1 hour. So if I start monitoring a port, if I monitor for 1 hour, I'll be getting a lot of data. So I need to hold it somewhere, right? So probably if I'm running Node or a local server, it may not be able to do that. But if I have Spark, I'm just distributing the data. My batch can be 1 hour or 10 hours or anything. So we had a similar situation. This Flipkart and all sale is happening, right? Freedom sale, some nonsense they're doing, right? Amazon, Flipkart. So there the same thing will happen. What they will do, they will be running streaming applications behind the scene, okay? And Flipkart uses Kafka. Everybody uses Kafka. So when users are browsing or buying stuff, right, all those information, like how many mobile phones. So let's say they put up a promotion on Moto G. Just an example, okay? So Moto G sale begins only on Moto G. So people want to buy Moto G probably. So what they do is that they will run a streaming application which will keep on polling this Kafka topic, where the data will land what people are searching for and what people are buying for, right? And then it will publish every 5 minutes or 3 minutes, the result. So it will be like in last half an hour, let's say 5,000 Moto Gs were sold and 10,000 people searched for it. So this statistics they need to see in real to understand whether they need to change the strategy. So in sale, that is how it works, right? Because that is real-time analytics. So there, if you're looking at it, millions of people are accessing the site, right? And Flipkart even tracks your mouse movements. So like I said, last year I was with the Flipkart for a couple of trainings with them. So they didn't allow me to go in depth into what they are doing and all, but they even capture a mouse movement. Like you, this, right? So that will be captured. Because they want to understand how the user in a particular UI, if they display the products, what are the chances a user will click an item on the right corner or left corner. So from a single user itself, huge amount of logs will come. So during a peak sale, they will get terabytes of data in real time. So that you cannot process using any single machine or a Node or anything, right? So then they want to understand what people are searching for and how many are actually buying. So the buying, if you're actually buying, let's say Moto G, I don't know, whatever you're buying, that is not handled by big data systems. That will be handled by RDBMS. Because there is reliability. If I'm paying money, I should either get it or not get it, right? So I cannot trust on any of these folks for that. So they have a big Oracle cluster setup where the financial transactions will happen. So when you place an order, actually when you pay, Oracle is handling the payments and all. And then it'll mark as bought, item bought, and you paid money and all. That data along from Oracle, there is a CDC from there, read and push it to Kafka. That is how they know how many people are buying in real time. So how many are searching, how many are buying in real time, and then a lot of ML on top of this. That is how they make decisions in real time. Otherwise, how it is not like a blind sale. Doesn't happen like that. You cannot just conduct a blind sale saying that
let people come and buy whatever they want. Doesn't work like that. Webband app. So they have their custom code to push. So they are using a combination of a couple of languages. I didn't go in depth into what they're doing, but they have their custom code to read weblogs, basically. They've written an application, and whatever the web server is writing as log file, it will read it, and it is a producer actually for Kafka. So it'll push it to Kafka directly. So the log files will directly land on Kafka. From there, they're monitoring. Because let's say I'm purchasing something, okay? That purchase is a log entry, or I'm searching something. Now that information might be needed by multiple people. One set of group will be who are monitoring what I'm doing. Another set will be doing some machine learning, let's say. So if multiple people need this information, it has to be in Kafka only. So the storage place for all this is Kafka for them. They have a custom producer for pushing this to Kafka. From Kafka, they read in real time. So there, this batch and sliding all will be important. Like in the every 2 minutes, I want to know how many people bought Moto G last half an hour. Just like that, I'm just saying. So that I can adjust my strategy, right? And they have a very excellent decision-making team. So what they do is that when these sales are happening, every 15 minutes, there will be a shuffle-in plan. Shuffle-in plan means we don't notice it actually. So they will have some products promoted and some products like mobile phones. So like an Apple iPhone 10, 30% off, imagine, right? So then, so how these offers are coming up is that this Flipkart is actually buying from somebody, right? They don't produce iPhone. So they will have some people who will give them iPhone and they will sell iPhone, right? So if they say 30% offer on iPhone, these guys will not give them at 30% rate, right? If I am selling to Flipkart, I will not sell on a lower rate. Then what is my profit? So I will sell to Flipkart on my original rate. And then Flipkart has to sell on a subsidized rate, right? And that they do with bulk amount. Like if they can sell so many units, then they are. So initially they will put up saying that Apple iPhone, now let's say 30% off. Okay. And then they will track real time how many people are visiting and let's say browsing for this mobile phone to see that. And if they see there is a less traffic for iPhone or something, they will start clubbing offers and displaying. They will say that now you also get 10% cashback or 5% cashback. Because they have to promote the sale of that product. Then only, otherwise what they bought, the units all are waste actually, right? So real time, they have to monitor and adjust the sales strategy. Then only this will work. It's a huge task actually. It is not so easy as we speak to conduct a sale and then sell things. It's not very easy actually, right? So this is a small part. It will not take much time, okay? And once we finish this, I will explain my case study, what I'm going to do. And then we will run the case study for real-time dashboards, okay? So now, so far we understood that we'll create something called streaming context, and then the data will come, we'll analyze the data. And like you saw the tweets, we'll just display whatever analytics we are doing. But the problem is, what if something goes wrong? What if something crashes? How do you recover in Spark Streaming? So that is things you need to know about reliable Spark Streaming. This is something which I already explained. So these are the popular frameworks. There is something called SAMSA, which is not very popular these days, but was there. Okay, I now remember when I looked at this slide. I have actually worked on Storm and Spark mostly. Flink little bit. SAMSA I have seen, but I have not gone into SAMSA. Then Akka is a very popular inter-process communication framework. And stream storage. Stream storage means once you are analyzing your data, then where will you store it, the result? You can use HDFS, you can use Kafka, AWS S3, Amazon Web Services. And this is EMR. This icon is EMR, Cassandra, so on and so forth. So we already know that storage is also like this. And these are the sources from where you can get. Have you heard about this MQTT, this thing, this guy? I forgot the expansion of this MQTT, but that is a source for IoT data. Like IoT data, if you want to consume, then the type of source is called MQTT source. Okay, I forgot the expansion, but yeah, from where can you get the streaming data? Through Twitter, Kafka, I don't know, Socket, this is Socket, and HDFS, from many places. Yesterday I told you that you can create something called file stream. Like you can monitor a folder, and if somebody places a file there, you can read it immediately. That is possible only in Scala. Python doesn't support it so far. So file streams are only supported in Scala, not in Python. Right? So file stream is not listed here, but yes, you can monitor a folder, and if somebody places anything in that folder, that stream will process. So let's say it is like 10 second worth batch. Within 10 seconds, how many files are placed in there? It will read it and start processing. But in Python, you cannot write that code. Only Scala is supported as of now. Yeah, so we already went through this. High level API is there, fault tolerant. You can integrate with these things. And receivers receive data streams and chop them into batches. Spark process the batches and pushes off the result. So right now what we did, in the code, if you look at, we wrote the code like this, right? The code we wrote is ssc.socketextstream. This is the code we wrote, right? So what does this mean? I'm using the Spark streaming context to create a socket text stream, which means I'm monitoring a port. This is a local host, this number. So this will create something called a receiver, a process called receiver. Then that receiver is responsible for monitoring the port and getting all the data. So receiver is actually a JVM process, which is, its job is just to connect with the whoever is sending the data and get the data. So that is what is mentioned in the slide here. So you'll get a receiver and then the result. So features in Spark streaming that help prevent data loss. Okay, a deeper view. How do you understand it? Yeah. So some of this I have already explained yesterday, but I think you can understand. So whatever, you have a Spark driver here, and then you will have either a Yarn, Mesos, or Spark cluster standalone, right? And when you say ssc.start, what will happen is that the driver will start running here, right? And one of this machine will start receiving the data. It will give the data to everybody to process. And let's say 10 seconds passed, 10 seconds is your batch. Okay, this driver will say run word count. It will run it. Again, next 10 seconds, run word count. So this guy is responsible for maintaining this batch interval and then pushing the code. But the data always resides in your cluster. So you are aware of Spark executor. Driver launches executors in the cluster, right? So once you start your Spark program, driver will start here, number of executors will come up, and then the program will start. So the tasks will be sent to individual executors to process the data, right? And this is what I'm saying, there will be a receiver, and typically the receiver will be running only on one machine. That's like a point of loss. Yeah, executor is not a physical machine. Correct. So when you are starting the shell, you can ask for number of executors, right? I want 3, I want 5, like that. But apart from executor, it will start a process called receiver. Okay, that is responsible for getting your data stream, right? And the driver runs receivers as long as running tasks. So you will say ssc.start, and the driver will immediately ask one of the executor to start a receiver. So the data will start flowing in, and then this guy will periodically launch task every 10 seconds or 20 seconds, whatever analysis you want to do, right? And receiver will divide the stream into blocks and keep it in memory. Blocks also replicated to another executor. So there are multiple strategies here. When we created our Twitter analysis, we did not use replication, but you can also say that I want to replicate the data. In that case, whatever data, let's say this guy is receiving, another copy will be in memory of another machine. So that is only for reliability. So let's say this guy crashes, then you know, still you are having one more copy of data in some other machine to process it. So that is one way in which you can ensure that it is reliable. Spark streaming is reliable. Okay, but we are not considering this as an option because this is very costly. If you are receiving, let's say, hundreds or thousands of GBs of data in real time, if I say replicate the whole data, then I need double the resources to keep the data, and that's not really a nice option to do, right? Every batch interval, the driver will launch tasks to process the blocks, right? And that's understood ideally. You will get the results as well. Now, how do you get fault tolerance in this? So why should you care about fault tolerance and what will fail in Spark streaming, right? So many streaming applications need zero data loss, okay? And there are some applications where you have at least one guarantee and exactly once guarantee. At least one guarantee means you might get duplicates because the data will be processed at least once. It can be more than once. Duplication can happen. No, not nature of the data. So that's what it is, the nature of your application. So some applications require exactly once processing. You don't want duplicates in the data. So for example, you are trending, counting the hashtags or trending topics. Now, even in the trending topics, they can be considered as at least once. Because if you're saying that you are allowing duplicates, it does not mean that every record is duplicated. Not like that. Some tweets might become duplicates. That's all it means. Not the nature of the data. So what I'm saying is that, let's say you are reading from Kafka, right? So this is a classic example. Okay, let's say you are reading from Kafka. So let's say I'm getting from Kafka, okay? Kafka in the older days, what used to happen was that, let's say you're reading from Kafka, somebody has to maintain this offset till what point you have read in Kafka. So in the older versions of Kafka, Kafka was not responsible for maintaining this. You have to maintain. So if I have a Spark streaming application, okay, this guy starts reading the data from Kafka. For some reason, it crashed. Imagine, and it restarted. Chances are very high it may pick up some old data which was already read. It may not start exactly from the last record. So the processing will happen again, right? But in the new versions of Kafka, this is avoided. Because in the new versions of Kafka, when you connect Spark streaming with Kafka, what will do is that Kafka will maintain all the metadata. Spark just has to read. So anytime if Spark crashes and go back to Kafka, Kafka will say that you read till this point. This is the next offset that you have to read. So you are getting exactly once processing. But if you are using the old API of Kafka, since it is not reliable, your Spark streaming also might not be reliable. If you crash and restart your entire program, chances are high that you may get duplicate records. You may process some of the records again, right? So certain applications are there where you need exactly once processing. Certain applications are there where you don't mind, let's say you're analyzing general trends. There I don't mind duplicates. For example, I want to know right now which are the top three hashtags in India. So obviously, let's say there is Modi, just an example, okay? Let's say Modi, then Kohli, then what? So I'm saying Modi hashtag is 1 million, just an example, okay? Kohli is like 90,000, example. Dhoni is 50,000. It does not matter if you get some duplicates. The numbers are so big, right? So even if Dhoni gets some 5 records additionally processed, it will become 50,005. Still the gap is maintained, right? But if you are doing event processing, complex event processing, like whenever a user is logging into a site, you need to get a message and you have to process that user logged in. If that comes as a duplicate, then that is a problem. So there, I don't want to have any duplicates. I want to know exactly how many people logged in. So that is the CEP, complex event processing. Normally, security systems and all, there you should not allow any sort of duplication. So now we are going to see how this can be guaranteed if you are using Spark, right? Different kinds of failures like executor and driver. So your driver can fail
and your executor can also fail. So what will happen? What if an executor fails? So if executor fails, receiver is lost and all blocks are lost. So let's say that particular executor failed, the first machine, right? This guy. My receiver was running on this machine. So what will happen? The receiver will also go. That means my stream will be go. I will lose all the data, right? So there is no hard and fast way to prevent this, because ideally Spark streaming allows only one receiver to be there. And if that fails, you don't have any choice, right? What if tasks and receiver restarted by Spark automatically? No configuration needed. But Spark will detect that this happened and it will restart the receiver on another machine. Like here, it will start a receiver. But if there is a time gap between these two, whatever data you had in that time, it will be gone. So if this crashes, immediately this will not be up, right? There can be some time delay, right? Say 1 minute it took. So during that 1 minute, whatever data was coming in, they will be lost. If you are directly receiving the data, let's say from Twitter, if you're reading from something like Kafka and all, it doesn't matter. Because you restart the receiver here, again you go back to Kafka, say that I want to read from the last offset, start getting the data. But in our example, right, we were doing the Twitter, there if my receiver is lost, 1 minute I restart, whatever tweets in that 1 minute is gone. I can't never get it back, right? So, but the good news is automatically your driver will restart the receiver. You don't have to worry about restarting of the receiver. So that is one failure thing. What if the driver fails? If the driver fails, everything is lost. Because your program itself will be gone, receiver will be gone, data will be gone, everything will be gone. Okay? But the question is there a way to restart the driver? Have you thought about it? What will happen if the driver fails in general? Maybe Spark streaming. So for that, you have to look at where your Spark is running. So you can run Spark on Yarn, you can run on Mesos, you can run on standalone. And each these cluster will have a way to restart your driver. So how the restart will happen? So one thing is that you have to do something called a destream checkpointing. So let me ask you this question. Your driver went down, right? Your driver went down in Spark streaming. Okay. And what Yarn did, Yarn understood that probably that machine crashed. Okay. And Yarn restarted the driver in some other machine. But the new machine driver, how it will know till what data was processed? Normally it will not know, right? Because the driver is the guy who is knowing that every 10 seconds I should process, right? And so if you have created batch intervals and sliding intervals, it knows that till 10 o'clock 10, I have processed the data. I want to read from here. All this information is with the driver. So if your driver crashes, and some other machine starts as a driver, it has no clue what was happening. It will start from the beginning basically. So to avoid that, driver will be restarted, but you have to do something called checkpointing. There is something called destream checkpointing. It's very simple. What you need to do is, you have to create a folder on HDFS or S3 while creating streaming context. And then you have to say that, save all the data related to your DAG in that folder. So what is going to happen? Normally when you create a streaming context, you will say like this. Where is it? When you create a streaming context, you will say streaming context. You will pass the Spark context and let's say 10. This is your batch interval. So now with this checkpointing, you have to also pass a argument calling that checkpoint folder. Meaning, what will happen, it will be a folder in HDFS, and when Spark streaming starts, whatever job it is doing, all the metadata related to this job, it will start pushing to this folder. And next time, if it crashes, and on some other machine the driver restarts, it will look at this folder to see whether any data was there. From there, it will start again.
So it is like remembering till what point you have processed. It will keep track of which driver is running and all, but it will not know what the driver is doing inside. Because this is a Spark streaming app. So this is a Spark streaming app. You might have a Tez application, you might have a Storm application. So every application cannot say that this is what I'm doing. Yarn is not aware of what you're doing inside. It can understand the state, like if the driver is down, it can know the driver is down. I need to restart the driver. But it does not know that this driver is processing 10 second batch or 20 second batch, or whether you wrote Spark streaming or Storm code. That information will not be passed. Normally, to avoid that, you have to use this checkpointing. So if I enable checkpointing, if it restarts, okay, automatically it will read this folder. Any data is there, it will understand, okay, till 1040 I have processed. So I have to start from here. I know that it will continue from there. Normal application, but that does not matter, because normal, this is streaming, it is running forever, right? Normal application will begin from scratch only, okay? This is what I was speaking so far. Spark streaming divides a data stream into batches of X seconds called a D stream. So what is this D stream? That's nothing but data that is coming in. So to give you an example, D stream is a continuous stream that will have individual batches of X seconds. So you will create something called a D stream. Okay, I will say that create a D stream. And then I will mention my batch interval, let's say 10 seconds. Okay, that means from that moment onwards, data will start continuously flowing. Right? And when that 10 second time comes, it will cut as a batch. Right? When that 10 second time interval happens, whatever data that you have collected during that 10 seconds, the action will be performed, whatever you're doing. So if you want to look at the architecture of Spark streaming, what basically happens is, this is your Spark cluster. Now you want to get the data, right? One way you can get the data is there is something called a text file stream. We are not doing this, okay? But in text file stream, what happens, like I said, you can monitor a folder, for example. Can be a local folder or a remote folder, okay? And whenever there is a file being placed in that folder, Spark streaming will read the file, right? And process it. Again, there you have this batch interval, 5 seconds or 10 seconds. So if somebody is keeping three files within 10 seconds, all three files will be read. Because that time actually matters. It's batch, end of the day, right? So text file stream is not very popular. So we'll not be doing that, but that is one thing. Second thing, and which we will actually be doing, is called a socket file stream. So what do you mean by socket file stream? So in Spark streaming, you have to create something called a streaming context. Remember in core Spark, you have a SC, that is Spark context. And in Spark SQL, we have something called Spark. Spark dot, you will say. In streaming context, in Spark streaming, you have something called streaming context. So first thing is that you will define the streaming context. And how do you define this? Is that you will pass normally two arguments. One is your SC. You will say that use this. Second is the batch interval, where you will say, let's say three. Three means this is your batch. In seconds. So in normal, in the version we are using and all, only seconds are supported. Like the lowest you can go is one second. The minimum batch interval is one, can be more than that, anything, right? In the 2.3.1 and all, they have a microsecond level, 1 microsecond all. But for the time being, we'll keep it as second. So I'll say 3 second. But there are a couple of things you need to understand. So let's say you define the streaming context as SSC. I will say SSC equal to new streaming context. I will say pass Spark context and 3. This is what I write in my code. So now I have my streaming context, right? Ready. And now the next type of stream is called socket file stream, right? And what is happening in socket file stream is that you can monitor a port number and then get the data.
So there is a way to mention the port number, where is the port number, which is the host and all. But ultimately, what is going to happen when you start Spark streaming? So here you have a lot of worker machines, right? These are what? Machines, right? Where you have executor and all, right? One of them will start running your driver. Driver will start here. Now, in this guy, imagine, okay? So imagine you're monitoring a port number. So let's say the port number is 67167, some number, okay? This port you want to monitor. So through this port, some data is coming in, right? Automatically, there will be a process called a receiver. This receiver is a process, it will spin up on one of the instance, and this is the guy who is responsible for getting the data, this receiver process. And this will run only on one machine, normally, okay? That means if this machine crashes, there is a problem. Once the receiver start getting the data, it can replicate the data. It can send, either it can replicate as a primary copy. So let's say I get the data here. So one block is here, one block is here, one block is here. Three blocks of data I got, right? And then the driver will start pushing the code, whatever analysis you want to do on these blocks. So this is like 3 seconds worth data coming as one block or three blocks, imagine. So that will be distributed among executors, and the driver, every 3 seconds, the driver will push the code because it is streaming, right? It should not stop. Every 3 seconds, this guy will push the code saying that analyze, analyze, and these guys will analyze whatever is there. So all of this is in memory, ideally. Okay, it can be persisted, but if you want the real speed, all of this has to be in memory. And the amount of data is less compared to batch, because once you process, probably you can delete the data. So real time, when you're looking at the data, data is less. So I can hold it in my RAM, right? Now the problem is, if this receiver machine crashes, I will lose the data. Correct. I'm not getting any data. So what will you do? I don't know. Driver machine crashes, again, I have a problem. My entire code will stop running. What will I do? So we will discuss these points in fault tolerance, like how, what will happen if something happens. But another point is that normally when you implement Spark streaming, it is a good idea. Like, let's say you are getting data from Twitter. Now Spark streaming has a direct API. Through that you can get the data from Twitter. So let's say you have Twitter here. Okay. I can get the tweets into a port number. Okay. So Twitter data will come to, let's say, 1111. Port number, and from this port number, my receiver will poll and get my data. But the problem with this is, if my receiver crashes, all the real-time tweets will be gone. So the better architecture is that from Twitter, you get the data to Kafka, right? From Kafka, you send it to your receiver. The advantage is that even if your receiver crashes, your data is in Kafka. Kafka never crashes. It is almost impossible for Kafka to crash. In reality, Kafka never crashes. Kafka has fault tolerance. It replicates. It is like Hadoop, not exactly like Hadoop, but when the data lands in Kafka, it replicates. So almost impossible Kafka crashes. But your receiver can crash any point in time. There is no guarantee. So it's always recommended that don't directly pull the data, pull through something like Kafka. So in case if your receiver crashes, you can still go to Kafka and ask, like, give me the data. You will get the data. So basically, this is how the architecture will work. So here, our batch interval is 3 seconds. So once time 3 seconds reach, whatever data is in all these guys, it will process. Again, next 3 seconds, it will do forever. And some important points to note down, you need minimum 2 processor cores to start Spark streaming. Why do you need 2 processor cores? Because one processor core will be used by receiver to get the data, and one will be used to distribute the data. This machine, I'm saying. You need minimum 2 processor cores. If you create a Spark context, so you will create the Spark context, right? Where you will say local star, local one. So if you create with local one, it will say that I cannot start Spark streaming. Because minimum 2 processors are required. One processor for running receiver, and one for sending the data to other nodes. Once you get the data, minimum 2, can be more than that. No, this will be 2 separate JVMs. This receiver is a separate JVM that will consume one core. And the second JVM is responsible. So receiver will just get the data. It will not do anything. The second is responsible for spreading the data to multiple machines. Once the receiver get the data, it has to be given for multiple machines to process. Spark streaming will not start. Normal processing will start. It will throw an error saying that you start with minimum 2. So it is there in the documentation that minimum 2. But the reason for that is this. So as a safe mechanism, they have mentioned you start with minimum 2 processor cores. Second thing is that once you define this SSC and all, you write all your logic and then you will type something called SSC.start. Once you type this and hit enter, your sparse streaming will start. That means then it will run 24/7. It will never stop. If you stop it, you cannot restart it. There is no way you can restart Spark Stream. You have to run the whole code again. Like, it is not like pause and resume. Not possible. So once you define SSC and write all your logic, you say start. And the analysis happens. Then you thought like, okay, I could have added one more line of code. Stop it, add everything, but you have to redo everything. You can't like pause and edit and then say, no, it doesn't work like that. No, I'm saying, let's say you have a code, right, where you have written just as a simple example, word count, just an example. Okay, you are getting some streaming data. You're doing word count on the data. You're just counting the words. And so you wrote all the logic. You said SSC.start and the processing starts. Now the data will keep on flowing and you will see the output, whatever word count is having, 10 second window or something, right? Now in the word count, let's say you want to do character count also, just as an example. Okay. Now I can say SSC.stop. There it will stop. Then I cannot say SSC.start. It will not start. Right? So it's not like stop and then restart. That doesn't work. Then I have to again recreate my streaming context, write all the logic, run all the code and start again. So once a streaming context is stopped, you can never restart it. I'm making these things up. It is there in the documentation. I mean, just to be sure that I'm on the right side. Spark streaming, if I go here, there was a interesting, yeah. Can you see these points to be remember? What is the first one? Once a context had been started, no computation can be set up. Once a context has been stopped, it cannot be restarted, right? So this is the thing I was talking about anyway. Yeah, so this is what is happening. You get an input data or stream and you will create batches of input data and then batches of processed data, right? And this is the time, right? So I will talk about this in a different example. Don't worry. Okay. Yeah. So we have something called a window operations and this is important. Now you have the example. We will look at the example later. So what is this window operation? So let me take a practical example. So you are analyzing stock data. Just as an example, stock, right? From somewhere you are getting the data, current stock price. So let's say every second it changes, right? Or every microsecond or something it changes. So you are getting huge flow of stock data and you want to analyze it in real time. Okay. And let's say you want to predict some stock price or which one should you buy or sell or something. Now, so what you have done is that you have defined your batch interval. 2 second worth data will get downloaded or be taken by Spark. So by default, if you don't do anything, what it will do, it will take this 2 second data, analyze it, show you the output, whatever logic you have written. But just to give more flexibility, we can also add something called a window interval. There is a property called, and there is one more property called sliding interval. So these two things additionally you can add. You may not see them very frequently, but some people use it, right? But you need to have an idea what it is. Somebody is asking you. So let's take an example. Your requirement is like this. You want to display a dashboard where the stock prices, you want to display the stock prices in a dashboard. Okay. And you are trying to display the stock prices What do you want to display? Stock prices in last 30 seconds, right? So look at what we are doing. Our batch interval is 2 seconds. So in this case, I will say my window interval is 30 seconds. I will explain this. And you want to do this, let's say, so this 30 is a bit bigger number. What is our batch? 2. So let's say every last 4 seconds. Okay. Let's say you want to do this every 6 seconds. Now, what does this practically mean? If you take a timeline, right? How do you take? I'm taking minute, okay? Because that's easy for you to understand. But in reality, this is, let's say, so let's take a timeline. We start at what time? 10 o'clock till 10 o'clock, 13 minutes. Now, you created a spark with all these three properties. What is going to happen is that your batch interval is what? 2 minutes. So you say start processing. And when will you get your first batch? Since your batch interval is 2 minutes, okay, every 2 minutes it's gonna dump a batch of data, right? Now, what is your requirement? You want to display stock prices in last 4 minutes. I want to know the stock price of last 4 minutes, right? So there is no way you can display anything at 10 o'clock. At 10 o'clock, you can't display anything because there is nothing before 10 o'clock. Your computation started at 10 o'clock. Also, your condition is that you want to run this every 6 minutes. So sliding interval is when your computation will happen. Every 6 minutes, my computation should happen. Right? So when will the first computation happen? Computation will happen because I have mentioned something called, sliding interval, where I'm saying that it is 6 minutes. That means I want to see some result every 6 minutes. Okay. At 6 minutes, what should I see? I need to see data worth last 4 minutes. So here, what it will do? It will analyze B2 plus B3. So first computation, it will just take B2 plus B3 and show me the output. Then what will happen? My window will slide. Because once my 10.06 analysis is over, okay, my analysis should happen every 6 minutes. Next analysis will happen only at 10.12. Not a interesting example, but I'm just giving the idea. At 10.06, what will happen? I want to know right now what is the last 4 minutes worth stock data. So it will just combine B5 and B6 and show me the output. No, I'm just giving a rough example. Here we are assuming that in a batch you get, let's say, complete data. So let's say you're looking at one particular stock. Let's say we are looking at one particular stock. Let's say Infosys stock. So Infosys stock will be there from 10 to 10:13. It might have gone up or down. That is the only thing, right? Infosys stock price could have gone up or down. So I want to display the result, or let's do something interesting. Let's say the sliding interval is, what is my batch? 2 minutes, right? So let's say my sliding interval is also 2 minutes. So if my sliding interval is also 2 minutes, every 2 minute calculation will happen. So what is going to happen? At 10:02, the calculation will kick in because my sliding interval is now 10 minutes, it's 2 minutes, right? But to process, it need minimum 4 minute data. So I don't have any data here. Nothing will happen because I have only 2 minute data. Next, 10:04, next processing will happen. There, do I have 4 minute data? Yes. What will happen? B1 and B2 gets processed. Then 10:06, next will happen. There, what will happen? B2 plus B3 will get processed. This is sliding interval, 2 minutes. Now I have changed it to 2 minutes. Sliding interval is when the computation should kick in. Sliding interval means when the computation should kick in. Batch interval means, sorry, window interval means how much data you have to process. Exactly, at 10:02. But there is no, but why I'm saying that my window interval is 4 minutes. Meaning I need minimum 4 minute worth data to process. Last 4 minutes data. So at 10:02, I don't have 4 minute data. So what happens, 10:04 I reach, again my computation will kick in. Do I have 4 minute data? Yes, I will process. This is particularly useful in many situations. So maybe not in all the situations you want, but
let's say like real-time dashboards, they want to display some statistics every X minute, which will go beyond backside, like last 30 minutes data, last 1 hour data, every 5 minutes, I want to display. So let's say again, you are displaying trending topics in Twitter. I want to display trending topics in Twitter. What is trending in Twitter? First question is that when you should display? Should you display every minute, every 5 minutes, every hour? So I will say that I want to display trending topics in Twitter every hour or every half an hour. Should change somehow, right? So every half an hour, I'm assuming that my trending topic will change. So my sliding interval is half an hour. Every half an hour, some computation will happen. But in that half an hour, should it display only half an hour trending topic or 1 hour trending topic or the whole day's trending topic? Correct. So it may change, right? So that is decided by my window interval. Batch is when it is downloading as the micro batches. So by adjusting all these three properties, you can control your, processing of data. Because in lot of monitoring, like we used to do this social media analytics a lot. So there the customer's requirement is like, he should get an alert or a dashboard change, let's say every 20 minutes. So every 20 minutes, the data should change, right? So if we are starting at 10 o'clock, 10:20, the analysis should kick off. Again, 10:40, the analysis should kick off. But when at 10:20 you're analyzing the data, are you considering only last 20 minutes data or last 1 hour data or last 10 hour data? That's a question, right? So that is your batch. That is your window. So that may be long. Because in Twitter's trending topic, you may be publishing trending topics every 5 minutes, right? Every 5 minutes you will display, right? But to get that data, get that answer, you may be analyzing last 1 hour or 2 hour. Then only you get trending topics. In 5 minutes, there is no trending topic. A whole day's data is required actually, but you should display something every 5 minutes, right? So that is your sliding interval. This is actually a very confusing topic, these three things. And if you read the documentation, you will not understand anything, by the way, right? Documentation is very bad on this. There are a lot of Google examples also. They are also very bad. Okay. So now how do you use it in the code, right? So when you're creating the Spark streaming context, you will mention only batch interval. When I create the streaming context, I will mention only batch interval. Okay. Then while computation runs, I have to mention these two factors. Like I'm doing word count, when the word count should happen and how much data it should consider. So that I have to mention in the word count code, not in the streaming context. You have these transformations for this window. Just I thought anyway, since I'm talking about it. See here, this is these streams. We already saw that. If I scroll down, window operation. See, this is an example of window operation. And these are the transformations. Can you see count by window, window length and slide interval, reduce by key and window? Do you remember reduce by key? In word count we used. So normally when you say reduce by key, it will do word count. Now I am saying reduce by key and window, where I will pass window length and slide interval. So I am saying that I want word count, fine, but when the word count should kick in, and how much data it should consider. So you have to call these transformations for that. So by default, so your batch interval is mandatory. You cannot create Spark streaming without batch interval. If you don't mention any of this, okay, the sliding interval and batch interval is almost same. If I don't mention this, batch interval and sliding interval are same. And window interval is not mandatory. Unless you mention, there is no default. So if I don't mention anything, what will happen? If let's say my batch is 2 seconds, it will get data every 2 seconds, process then and there. So this is slightly a confusing concept, but you have to at least understand the basic of it.
This brings us to the end of this Spark streaming tutorial. Now, before you guys sign off, I'd like to inform you that we have launched a completely free platform called Great Learning Academy, where you have access to free courses such as AI, cloud and digital marketing. So guys, thank you very much for attending the session. And have a great learning ahead.